27 in your hymn. Grab a hymn, Mama. Once you have it, you get there. You probably don't need it, though. We know the song. We really need it. Bless the Lord, oh my soul.
Strength in the name of the Lord. There is power. comes to sing my great Redeemer's praise. The glories of my God and King, the triumphs of His grace. Jesus, the name that charms our fears, that bids our sorrows cease. His music in the sinner's ears, His life and help and peace.
And on the last,
my gracious Master and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread through all the earth and throng the honors of Thy name.
That was short and sweet, Brother Ron.
Start in the Lord's house is a good start.
Amen.
And then hope that we continue to have people who commit to being at the church throughout the year, and in supporting the ministry of the church through tithes and offerings. And if I could have the ushers I've asked to help put that come forward. Could you please ask a blessing on the offering?
Lord, we are thankful for this day and your many blessings. And we pray that you would bless this part of our service, Lord, as each of us can take part in this and giving back to you, Lord, as you've blessed us, and we'll praise you for it. Amen.
Page 30, one of my favorite hymns. 1529 tells a story. It's a biblical, it's a scriptural song. Mighty fortresses are God, bold, never failing. It goes on, for still our ancient foe, anybody care to guess who that is? The devil. He does seem to work us woe. His craft and power are great, and armed with cruel hate. There's nobody on earth is equal. And did we in our own strength confide, look at verse 2, our striving would be losing, were not the right man on our side, a man of God's own choosing. Do you ask who that may be? Christ Jesus, it is He. Lord Sabaoth, His name, from age to age the same, and He must win the battle. Just, if you're not going to sing, just read these words. They're beautiful and they're powerful.
Amen.
here it is, 2018. And I remember back in 2000, there was so much talk about it's the end of the world. It didn't happen. But Lord, how grateful we are to know that if today was the day, you made a provision for us to make it to heaven. We thank you, Lord, for loving us the way you did. We're thankful for John 3:16. God so loved the world that he gave. And we've said so many times, that's the way that verse could end. For God so loved the world that he gave. But it goes on. He gave your one and only son for us. Thank you, Lord, for that. And Lord, today as we look around our congregation, we have so many that are out sick today. We pray especially for Sharon that your hand will be upon her and bring healing to her body. We thank the Lord of Louie and Kathy and little Isaac that are all homesick. And we just lift each of them up and pray that you just touch them in a special way. And Lord, we know that there are many that are facing some surgery that are coming on. We pray, Lord, for Bonnie, and she's probably going to be looking in that direction. I know Kathy's got some possibilities coming. And I thank Lord Pat Bardeman. We pray especially, Lord, for Terry Smothers that's been dealing with some back issues, a real bad cough. We just pray that you touch her. We pray, Lord, for Norma, Maggie, that you'd be close to them. And we pray for Greg today, Lord. You know the issues that he's facing right now. We just pray that you put your big arms of love around him and draw him close to you. And Lord, we're thankful for your goodness to each one of us. But Lord, we know the old enemy is around us and doing his very best to try to cause all kinds of problems and consternations. We just lift them up. And then, Lord, we pray for Heather, two children that are down sick, and we just pray that you touch them. Close to him. I pray for Gary that's starting to get over this thing that's been going around. I pray that you touch him. And then, Lord, we just pray today that you would touch some that I probably have forgotten. But how glad I am that I serve a God who never forgets. You know what's going on. You're not going to forget. And so collectively, we lift up all of our needs to you and pray in a special way. That you meet every need that's represented in our church today. And Lord, we want to tell you again that we love you and we thank you for what you've done, what you're doing, and what you're going to do for us tomorrow. And would you remind us, Lord, as we prepare our hearts for communion, that communion is not just something where we think about the past, but it's also a reminder that we're to think about Jesus' soon return for the church. Prayer is that all of us would be ready. I pray now that you bless us, and as we pray each Sunday, we ask that you walk up and down each pew, and would you give each one of us that Big Daddy's hug we need, and we'll be careful to give you the praise, the glory, and the honor, for it's in Jesus' name we ask all these things. Amen. Terry Baldwin, come read scripture for us.
Stand for reading of God's holy word, read from Luke 22:15-20. And he said to them, I have eagerly desired to eat the Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God. After taking the cup, he gave thanks and said, take this and divide it among you. For I tell you, I will not drink again from the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. Let's bow our eyes, our head for a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, as we come for you today, Lord, after having read these verses, we know that we should remember the blood that Jesus shed for us every day of our lives. And starting out this year, we should put that as our number one thing, and putting you first, God, in our lives, and all of the things will come to us. Bless this day for the ones who came out. And we ask all these things in the name of Jesus Christ, and for his praise and for his glory. Amen.
Well, I hope you had a wonderful Christmas and a blessed Happy New Year. We did, but I told Faith, I said, we need to come home and take a vacation for the vacation. It's always good to be with our grandkids, three in Colorado and two in Oklahoma. And they're all teenagers now, starting from 17 down to 14. It seemed like it was just yesterday they were all infants. They grow up so quick, don't they? So quick. I told Kimberly, I said, well, everybody's getting old except you and me. And she went, really? a couple hundred years ago, there was a legend, a story that was going around about the fact that there were some Roman soldiers about 2,000 years ago that were looking for a blacksmith that could make four nails to crucify Jesus. And they looked and looked and looked, and finally they found a gypsy blacksmith, and they gave him the order, paid for the nails. And after he had finished the third nail, they said, we'll take this through, we can't wait any longer. He said, but you paid for it. I said, forget it. So they took the three nails, and you know the rest of that story. But that blacksmith thought, well, you know, they've been paid for, so I'll go ahead and finish it. He pulled it out, if you've ever seen any of the old, maybe Gunsmoke or some of those stores where the blacksmith pulls out the horseshoe and it's bright red. This nail was just glowing bright red. Well, he put it in the water and it still glowed. He dropped it in the bucket of water and it still glowed. He took it outside and buried it in some sand and it was still growing, glowing very brightly. And finally, he dropped it in the well and he could look down and still see that it was glowing. Well, that's a legend. I don't know whether that really happened or not. But there is one thing that did happen. There is one area of truth. There is a glow in the believers of Christ whenever we get ready to take communion, isn't there? Amen. When we take communion, it's a very special time because it helps remind us of what Jesus Christ did for us on the cross. His body was broken for you and me. His blood was shed on cruel Calvary for you and me. And that glow will be rekindled every time we meet together, and especially when we meet together at God's table, the communion table, to take communion together. Well, the sermon this morning I want to talk to you about is the first communion. The first communion. And if you'd like to fill in the blanks in your bulletin, let's get started. When we look about the first communion, we need to understand that it is a celebration. It's a celebration through the centuries. It started in the upper room with Jesus and his disciples. It continued through the early church years. And so it's probably a good thing for us to take a look at in our study this morning as we begin to study what communion is all about. Now, there are some symbols about communion. So what are the symbols of this celebration? Well, first of all is the bread. The bread represents the bread of life, Jesus Christ. His body was broken for you and me. And then there's the cup. And when we think of the cup, we think about the wine or the juice, which symbolizes his blood that was shed for us on Calvary's cross. Now, how many times have you heard someone say, Pastor, perhaps, we're going to celebrate communion? Well, what are we celebrating? Let me share some things with you about that. Number one, communion celebrates free salvation. Free salvation. Now, communion's message is the gospel. You know the word gospel means the good news. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15, verses 3 and 4, for what I received I pass on to you as first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. Now, a second thing the gospel offers is free salvation for sinners. Free salvation for sinners. And it is so free for the sinner, you and me. It's a free gift. And all we have to do is accept this wondrous gift. If you were raised in a family with a similar mind, there was one thing that my dad always used to say, son, there's no free gift. There's no free lunch. There's nothing free. You've got to work for everything. Have you heard that before?
Yeah.
And sometimes we as Christians kind of parlay that to what God supposedly said. But salvation, he didn't say that. It is free. All you and I have to do is reach out and take it. It's there. But what was free for us had a tremendous and awesome cost for Jesus Christ. For you see, it cost him his very life. Wasn't free for him. It was the total offering of himself for you and I. Now, the gospel declares faith in Christ is the only way to be saved. No one comes to the Father except through me, through Jesus. You can't get saved any other way. You have to go through Jesus. Your good works cannot bring salvation. But isn't it amazing today in our society, there's so many, many people that think, well, if I want to make it to heaven, I've got to do more and more good things. I've got to do good deeds. I've got to do this. I've got to do that. Paul said, no. Sometimes I would love to have met Paul, wouldn't you? Hear him talk. I could hear him go, no, 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 no. What's wrong with you people? Here's what he said, for it's by grace that you've been saved, and not of yourself, lest no one can boast, but through grace. Grace is undeserved, unearned favor of God. God loved you so much that he gave us John 3:16, didn't he? For God's love of the world that he gave his only begotten Son. You cannot give enough of who you are or what you own to earn your salvation. You don't have enough blessings or finances or material things. You don't have enough. So God said it's free. All you have to do is reach out and take it. And you can't do a single thing to do it, because if we did, what would we do? We'd boast. We'd boast about it. Well, look what I did. I remember growing up in Ohio, and there was a t-shirt that went around and a bumper sticker also that said, I'm humble, just ask me. You ever seen that? Remember that back in the 60s, I guess it was? But understand that communion in and by itself doesn't bring salvation either. Communion calls us back to the cross. Communion calls us back to the cross. Now, a second series here. Communion celebrates full forgiveness. Full forgiveness. A synonym for full is total. Total forgiveness. Has the devil ever reminded you of your past? He doesn't mind all the time. He's always telling me how bad I've been. But let's think with me for a minute about this first communion. Consider the people who were there for that first communion. Peter was there. Peter was the one that said, though all the rest of them deny you, run away, turn their back on you, I won't. I think he probably needed one of those shirts. I'm great, just ask me. But he said, they'll do it, but I won't do it. And he's the one that denied that he even knew Jesus three times. I don't even know the man. And he called down curses upon himself. He was at that first communion. And then there was a man named Thomas. Have you heard the name Doubting Thomas? He was there. He was the one that denied the resurrection had occurred. Even though Jesus had said several times it was going to happen. Thomas said, unless I can touch those holes, unless I can see them, I won't believe it. And then all the rest of the so-called faithful, they were all going to be loyal to the Lord too. But what did they do? They all rejected him. And they ran away too. They ran away for their very lives, or so they thought. But the good news is these fearful ones would be fully forgiven. Fully, totally forgiven. Have you ever forgiven somebody for something that to them was a big deal and to you wasn't a big deal? It's no big deal. It's done. It's over. Have you ever said that to somebody? Say, oh, I'm so sorry for what I did. Hey, it's okay. It's no big deal. It is over. And I don't think about it anymore. But it's right here in front of their minds. Well, when God forgives us, it's over. It's no big deal. It's done with. And so these fearful ones would be fully forgiven. Peter would be forgiven, and he'd become the spokesman of the church. Thomas, the one who gave that weak cry, a week later, my Lord and my God. And the other disciples, these were the ones that became the nucleus of the dynamic of that early church. And then when we think about communion, communion reminds us that we can be fully forgiven, totally forgiven. And here's the good news, there is no cosmic computer that contains any records about those sins that have been covered by blood. It's gone. You know, I find it amazing, on our Android phones, they're old now, and things aren't working on like they should be. I got a letter from our zone NMI, or an email from our zone NMI president, and I thought, okay, I'll answer that. She told me, she said, Pastor Steve, she said, I've heard from the missionary that's coming to your church in February, and I want to make sure you knew about it. And I wrote back, reply, and when I hit reply, I started loading messages. Loading messages, and that irritates me. You know, I have a phone that's supposed to work. It's not supposed to do all that stupid stuff. I don't want you to load the message, just reply. And so I had to go in and send her another message and off the page and do it that way, and it went fine. And I said, well, I've already heard from him. In fact, I've talked to him two or three times already. Oh, okay, thanks. But you know, sometimes we get in a position where things just don't work the way they should. And I don't know about you, computers have their use, and sometimes computers just irritate me. Amen. They just irritate me to no end. The computer that we have at home. Well, I came in Thursday afternoon and was doing some work here at the church and turned the computer on and got ready to go. And I waited. And you know me, I'm not real good on waiting. And I went, all right, let's get this dumb thing working here. And guess what? It must have hurt. It must have heard I was going to lay hands on it because it started working finally. So it was still slow, but I got out what I wanted to do. And then I went home. Turned the office computer on, which is a good computer, and waited some more. Frustrating. While I was waiting, I said, well, I guess I'll turn the TV on. So I turned the TV on Fox News, and it just showed me the guy started talking, and all of a sudden, a little box on top of the TV, the blue light started flashing on and off, and my picture went away. Really? Is this a revolt against me? Is this the machines? Some of you know I have on my phone, I have one of those little serpent things that will talk to each and argue back and forth. And I have a lot of fun arguing with it. I'll tell it things like, are you just stupid or what? And I said that one time, and here's what the thing said to me. I will remember that when robots take over the world. It's like, really? So I thought, well, maybe the revolt's taking place and they're trying to do me in. Well, I went in where Faith was at and turned hers on, and it said something like, well, the thing's in shut-off mode because you had it on and it hadn't been used. So I said, oh. So I turned hers, hit okay, went back and I started working. I guess if you have patience and you don't get too upset, you can figure most of that stuff out, but I don't like that. You? I just want to get it done, I want to get going. And you know, it's the same thing, the computers will just keep a record. I told Faith, I got all kinds of utilities on my computers and on my telephone, so I clear all this junk off. And if you've ever looked at Google, there's a history. If you go to settings or something, it says history. And everything that you have looked at on Google is there. When you have all that this material, it slows your phone down. So, you know, I was pretty proud of myself. I figured out how to do it, and so I was cleared all that stuff, and I clicked on that bottom little icon thing, and it said, no history. And I said, good job, Steve. But then all the way at the top, there was another three little line thing, and I clicked on that, and I had all the way, I went back as far as November, and there was history. And so no wonder my phone had slowed up. And I said, you know, I don't want to have to sit here and click on each one of these and delete them, which is what I started doing. That's a lot of work when you go back to November. And so I thought to myself, you know, there's got to be some kind of an application I can get.
I've got the application. It's just called History Remover on my phone. Put that in, did everything, and clicked the button, and it was all gone. And I said, praise the Lord, it's gone. There's no more record of it. That's the good news about what God does. When God forgives you, He clicks that history eraser, and it's gone. Your past is gone.
Amen.
It's not there anymore. It's here in your mind, but it's not in His mind.
Yeah.
You know, there's about 5 or 6 verses that I've got here that God talks about how when He forgives us, He forgets. If you want to jot these memory verses down as I read them, the first one's Isaiah 43:25. Listen, this is God. I am He who blots out your transgressions. There's a real interesting, when you look at that word blot, and you go back to the original Hebrew, when they would have the scrolls, and the scribe would handwrite the scripture on something like a papyrus. And he would write all that. Well, every once in a while he'd go back and say, oh, made a mistake. Let me get my eraser out. They didn't have erasers, did they? They had something like ink that was made from plants. Well, they also came up with an ink from the plants, and what they would do is they'd take that ink and blot out the words that needed to be taken out. And I thought about that. You know, we don't have anything like that. Well, yeah, we do. If you've been around for a while, you remember something called whiteout. Remember whiteout? I think I still have a bottle around the house somewhere. It's just white ink. You reach in, take that brush, and just put it over. You can't see it anymore. And that's what God is saying here. When I forgive you, I blot out your transgressions. Why does He do it? He says, for my own sake. And I remember your sins no more. They're gone. And then in Jeremiah 31:34, God says, for I will forgive their wickedness and will remember their sins no more. And then there's one in Micah 7:19. You will once again have compassion on us, and you will tread our sins underfoot and hurl all of our iniquities into the depths of the sea. We were stationed in Guam in the Air Force, and it's some of the deepest water on planet Earth. I think it was around 26,000 feet deep off. Can you imagine throwing something 26,000 feet down? You're not going to get it again, are you? That's what God is saying to us here. And then in Isaiah 38:17, in your love you kept me from the pit of destruction, and you have put all my sins behind your back. And you know, when I was younger, I did not like having a cowlick. You know, you like cowlicks. And you know, I would get done and comb my hair, take a shower, comb my hair, and I'd look in the mirror and I'd have a cowlick sticking up. I said, oh, and I tried to get it down, but I really didn't get it down. But then Dad put a medicine cabinet on each side of the wall. So I'd say, hey, that's cool. And I could pull it out and I could see it. But I couldn't see it without that other mirror because it was behind my back. And so God's saying, He throws it behind His back, which means I can't see it anymore. It's gone. And then how about Psalm 103:12? As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us. And the last one is Hebrews 10:17. Their sins and lawless acts I will remember no more. That's the kind of God that you have. Not only does He forgive you, He forgets about it. You know, with us, if someone does us wrong, we have a tendency to go, well, you did it again. I did forgive you the last time. And you know, I think it was June 24th of the year before that, you did say that again to me. And I think it was in May of 2013 that you did it too. We have a tendency to remember the past, don't we? But God says, when I forgive you, I forget about it. That's the kind of God that you serve. Aren't you glad that He loves you that much? And then God's Word says that when He forgives us, He forgets our sins. He forgets about it. It's as if they had never happened in the first place. Now, sad to say, we're the ones that don't forgive ourselves so many times, aren't we? There's so many times that we really mess up. And God forgives us. We confess our sins, he's faithful and just. Okay, I do all that stuff, and I accept by faith that you've forgiven me. But then we keep remembering what we did. You know what the reason is? We have a supernatural enemy who hates us, hates you, hates God. And so he does his very best to bring your sins, your past, up to the front of your memory. He wants you to remember, not to forgive yourself. But here's something I told you before. When Satan reminds you about your past, remind him of his future. Revelation chapter 20, verse 10. And the devil, who deceived them, was thrown into the lake of burning sulfur with the beast and the false prophet, where they had been thrown. And there they will be tormented day and night forever. And we could add that, and forever and forever and forever and forever. That's what his future is. Or when Satan reminds you of the past, we need to remember that those sins that he's reminded us of were forgiven, and they were under the blood of Jesus Christ. And we need to say, wow, Satan, thank you for reminding me that Jesus forgave me for those sins and they're under the blood of Christ. Wow, I feel like singing. Let's sing "Oh How I Love Jesus." Do you want to sing the first verse of the chorus? James says, resist the devil and he'll flee. The best way to do that is to accuse him of praising Jesus, isn't it? He don't want to do that, does he? And then a third thing, communion celebrates our fantastic future. You know, one of the things I've wondered, do any of you know how many times you've taken communion? If you've been in the Church of Nazarene for a long time, you know the church used to say, well, let's take it quarterly, at least quarterly. And so I got thinking about that. What if I did that quarterly, and let's just look at 50 years. Now, I'm just a year or two older than 50, you know that. But 50 times 4 quarterly, that would mean that I take communion probably about 200 times. That's a lot of times. But you know, I wonder sometimes when we take communion, is there a special memory we have it? Or when we walk in the sanctuary and we say, okay, well, George and Bonnie got communion set up, so I guess we're going to have communion again. And I guess the pastor's going to have a sermon on communion on the body and, you know, the wine and all that kind of stuff. We'll get through it. Or do you stop to think what communion is all about? Do you stop to think about John 3:16, Romans 5:8? Do you think about what God did for us when you take communion? Is communion, does it have any special meaning for you the very next day? Sometimes we take communion, and you know, I can remember growing up in the Church of Nazareth when communion was really a big deal. You know, and we've seen it done all different ways. I've been in some churches where the pastor would have to set up the men, the stewards, and what have you. You just stay in your seat, and they would pass it. Well, then we got a little bit more progressive, and we moved them to every other row so the stewards could walk down in front. And, of course, the traditional one that most of us like to do is come to the altar. It's a little bit symbolic about being at the altar of Christ. No magic to it. It just makes it easier where we can get together and get closer to the table. But I wonder, when you take communion today, when you leave, will it have a different meaning than it did before today? Communion is something that's so interesting. It helps us think about what Christ did for us, but yet it also helps us celebrate future. The future for his return. So communion, your next point there, communion celebrates our fantastic future. Our fantastic future. Here's what Paul says. We will be caught up to be with Christ at the rapture. He said, brothers and sisters, we don't want you to be ignorant about like those who have died. We don't want you to grieve like other people who have no hope. We believe that Jesus died, that he came back to life. And we also believe that Jesus, through Jesus, God will bring back those who have died. And they will come back with Jesus. Now, we're telling you what the Lord taught. We who are still alive when the Lord comes will not go into his kingdom ahead of those who have already died. But the Lord will come from heaven with a command, with the voice of the archangel, with the trumpet call of God, and first, the dead who believed in Christ will come back to life. and then to gather with them. We who are still alive will be taken in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and in this way we will always be with the Lord. And you know, in Corinthians, Paul talks about this, 1 Corinthians 15, 51 and 52, and he says it will take place in the twinkling of an eye. Now, as a young man, I used to think twinkling of an eye, that means a blink. Well, that's pretty fast, isn't it? But you know, I shared with you, I don't know, a year or two ago on this. I looked it up. I Googled it. If you Google, you know it's going to be right. I Googled it, and Google tells me that a twinkle of an eye is 1/1,000,000th of a second. That's pretty fast, isn't it? That's pretty fast. The rapture is going to take place in the twinkle of an eye. And you know, I was telling Brian, my son, he said, how long have you been pastoring, Dad? And I said, well, retired in March. If I would stay until June, I'd have 30 years. He said, that's a long time. You're pretty old, aren't you? Yeah, I guess I am, son. Thank you for reminding me of that. But you know, over the years, I've had a lot of people say, well, when the rapture comes, I'll know it. And right when it comes, I'm gonna say, forget it. That's all I got to say, right, preacher? Yeah. But are you sure you're going to have enough time? No, I was thinking blink of an eye. I don't think you have enough time to say forgive me with blink of an eye. But 1/1,000,000th of a second? Wow. Wow. So Paul's telling us all about this, how it's going to end up. But then he adds this verse. Are you ready for this? So then, after what you've heard, comfort each other with these words. You know, when we live on this earth, we're going to have problems, aren't we? That's just the way it is. Scripture tells us that. Don't think it's strange when these things happen to you. Paul says when these things are happening to you, comfort each other. You know anybody's going through a rough time right now? You know, one of the neatest things you can say is, you know what? You're going through some real issues. When Jesus comes back and the rapture takes place, let them try to catch you. You won't be here. You won't have to worry about the washing machine breaking down. You won't have to worry about the car breaking down. You won't have to worry about people issues. You won't have to worry about any of that stuff. Why? Because we're out of here. And so Paul says, comfort each other with these things. So if you see somebody's going through a tough time, comfort them. You're going through a health issue. Guess what? One day, probably pretty soon, you're going to have to deal with it. You know, sitting there looking at Norma. Norma's dealing with some issues. And you know what, Norma? One day you won't have to deal with it anymore. Won't that be great? You go up to be with the Lord. All that stuff will be gone. So comfort each other with these words. And then the second thing, he tells us that we will spend time with Christ. We will spend time with Christ. In John 14:3, Jesus said, if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again. And then I will bring you into my presence so that where I am, you may be also. And then Revelation 19:7-9 tells us that we will celebrate with him and worship with him at the Lamb's Supper. The marriage supper, won't that be great? And after that's over, we will return to the earth with Christ to reign with him forevermore. We'll return with Christ to reign forevermore. And then fifthly, communion looks back to the cross. Communion looks back to the cross and forward to Christ's return. Paul said, every time you eat this bread and drink from this cup, you tell about the Lord's death until he comes. So here's the neat thing about it. Communion celebrates sinners as being made saints. Best is yet to come. In 1 Corinthians 2:9, here's what Paul said. But just as it is written, listen to this, things that no eyes have seen or ears have heard or mind imagined are the things that God has prepared for me and you, for those who love him. You know, the Jews believed that the very first thing the Messiah would do when he came to the earth was to have a great banquet. But you know what? In the end, one of the last things that Jesus did was have a communion supper, wasn't it? You call it the Holy Supper. And you look at it, and the supper probably didn't seem like much of a banquet. There was only a crumb of bread. There was just a sip of wine out of the cup. But the memory of what happens when we take communion and how we feel lasts a lot longer. It lasts until we come again for communion or until the Lord comes back, doesn't it? You know, one of the neatest things that I have found out is listening to kids what they think about church. Listen to what kids have to say about communion. Let me share just a few thoughts with you about what some kids have thought about communion, and then we'll kind of wrap it up with what they think about the church. Well, Seth, who was a 5-year-old curious boy, couldn't keep his eyes off the parents as they were taking communion. And as the dad took the communion, receiving the elements, the little boy was just watching him. Eyes were glued to him, and mom's thinking, good parental example. But it was kind of short-lived because the little boy looked at his mom and he whispered into her ear, what in the world is in that stuff? As soon as they take it, it knocks you right out. Elaine Bircher shared, one weekend my little brother went to stay with his grandparents and they took him to church. And at church they had communion that they had last supper. And the little boy had never seen it before, so he asked his grandpa, he said, what is this? What's going on? He said, well, this is the Lord's last supper. The boy thought for a few seconds and went, wow, they sure didn't feed him very much, did they? And then there was a 3-year-old that took her first communion. Pastor patted her on the head as he gave her the elements and he said, God be with you. She went home. And her mother watched her. She got all of her dolls out, set them down on the ground, and had them in a circle. And she had some pieces of bread, and she broke it out and gave each of them a piece of bread. And she said, she patted them on the head, then she said, God will get you. But here's one about 4-year-old Jasper, what he thought about the church. He was visiting his grandpa's, and they'd gone to church in their home. The grandpa's in the study. He's very intently reading. And Jason walked in carrying a peach, and he said something that grandpa didn't quite catch. And so he handed him the peach, and grandpa thought, well, good. Grandma's sending me a snack while I'm reading. So he ate it up. And when he finished that last bite, little Jason looked at him with lips quivering, and he went, but Pap, I didn't want you to eat it. I just wanted you to take the worm out. You see, what we have here is a failure to communicate. And you know, it's so extremely important with kids, whether they're your kids or your grandkids or your great-grandkids. If you're with them when communion's going on, make sure they know what it's all about. You know, when we think about communion, communion uses as symbols the bread, which is symbolic of his body that was broken for us. The wine or the juice, which is symbolic of his blood that was shed for us. The bread was a symbol to represent his body that would be broken. And the wine or the cup was used as symbolic of his blood that would be shed for us. And you know, I read back in some church history, and I read that the early church in the book of Acts, often whenever they got together, they had communion. When they gathered around the table, they had communion because they saw that every time they got together and they gathered around, it was an opportunity or it was a chance for them to recognize Jesus and thank God for what he'd done for them. That's what communion is all about. Well, we're ready to take another communion. What's changed since you arrived, since you heard what I had to say to you? And since this thing began to work, has there been anything changed? And what will change? Will you remember what we talked about for a while? Maybe a day or two anyway. And how will you proclaim the good news of this celebration while we do communion? Those I've asked to help me, would you come? Prepare our hearts for communion. Father, we are so grateful for your goodness to us. Thank you, Lord, for the fact that Jesus came as part of the divine Trinity's plan, the great plan. And Jesus, in my mind's eye, I kind of see Jesus telling the Father, I volunteer, I'll give my life, I'll become one of them, and then I'll die for these people. Lord, we can't begin to say thank you enough. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for putting up with us. I pray that you bless our hearts as we prepare to take Holy Communion. In the Church of the Nazarene, we practice what's called open communion. That means you don't have to be a member of the Church of the Nazarene. You don't have to be a member of Rose Hill Church of the Nazarene. If you're a Christian, you've asked God to save you. You are invited and welcome to take communion with us. But you know, the Apostle Paul said, before we take communion, he asked us this. He said, examine yourself. Is there anything in my life, anything that would cause me to have some problems between you and me? And if there is, John the Apostle said it this way, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just and will forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So all you need to do is say, Lord Jesus, please forgive me and accept my faith and answer your prayer. Bow your head with me. Lord, collectively we ask you, is there anything we've done or said that gives you dishonor? If so, would you please forgive us right now? And through an act of faith on our part, we believe you've heard us. And we thank you in advance for forgiving us. Now bless us, Lord, as we participate at your table. I think there's room for everybody to come on down, kneel at the altar or the pews. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was broken for you, preserve you blameless unto everlasting life. Take and eat this in remembrance that Christ died for you. And the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was shed for you, preserve you blameless unto everlasting life. Drink this in remembrance that Christ's blood was shed for you. Thank you, Lord, for the ritual of communion. Thank you again for the privilege we've had to gather together in your church. We know the church is the people. Thankful, Lord, for each one that's here today. I pray, Lord, that this will be a special communion that we'll not forget as we start out on the first Sunday, January of 2018. We don't know how 2018 is going to end. Is it going to end like 17? Or what if 2018 were the year, or was the year, rapture took place? My prayer is that each one of us, Lord, will be ready. There'll be nothing that will stand between us with the trumpet call came, and the dead in Christ rise first, then we would turn alive and meet him in the air. Lord, we want to be in that number. Thank you for being with us. Bless us now as we go our separate ways. Give us a great work for Jesus. Bless all those, Lord, that are sick and having health issues. We just lift them up. And other problems that we're facing, help us to be reminded. And help us to remind each other of these things. Hang in there. It won't last forever.